this seminar came about as a vision or dream of Edwin's, because in his travels he has seen so many gifted and talented people, but they didn't have avenues to display their gifting because they weren't musical or weren't musical only, but there were other facets of them: fashion, dance, drama, and even art that needed to be exposed to the overall public, but also those that were potential in any of those places and could learn from people who were already in the industry, who were Christians, who loved the Lord, and who followed and, you know, walked in the Spirit of the Lord for those things. So he had a desire to have a music and arts seminar. Everybody was having their music seminars, but nobody was really, and others were doing arts, but they weren't putting them together. So Ed wanted to put them together, and I think the plenary session was at the Hilton, and then the actual first convention was at the Holiday Inn in San Francisco. And at that time, there were a lot of positions that were available to be open, but we didn't have, of course, anyone to fill them. So myself, Charlene Hall McCoy, and a couple of other members that were here at that time, were also part of the Gospel Music Workshop of America, which was founded by late Reverend James Cleveland. And we'd been there for a number of years in registration, because Charlene would run registration, and then I had privy to some information on how to set a few things up and get them in order. So we ended up just putting things together, you know. And at that time I was working with Minister Eltina Dixon McCree, and I was at the travel agency, so we just utilized that avenue, and we called different instructors and so forth that Edwin had gotten in touch with, and had them send their bios, and we did a souvenir book, and I ended up putting the souvenir book together. And then when it came time to open the checking account, I went and opened the checking account. You know, it was like, you know, I wore a headband, whatever needs to be done, let's just do it. When seminar time came, and I was dealing with coordinating the mass choir and working with the talent and all of those things. So there's almost outside of transportation, there's almost no office in operation now that I didn't have to do some work in, which was, it was a lot of work, but it was still a lot of fun. And it was a real great experience, because it was new, it was fresh, and it was something that a lot of people said needed to be done, you know. At that time we had it in April, so we had a nice turnout, but it wasn't as large as we wanted it to be, because we had based it upon our school year here being a time of the Easter break, and finding out that people around the United States did not have that break at the same time. You know, some had it after Easter, some had it a few days before. Here in the Bay Area, we had a week before. So later on, a few years after that, we changed it and moved it to the end of June, which seemed to work better for those that desired to come. And it wasn't designed to be in competition with any other convention that was happening, but it was designed to be a convention that would give a different aspect or a different presentation of another place in the body of Christ. And so it's centered a little earlier than the National Chorus, Gospel Chorus Convention, which was founded by Thomas A. Dorsey, or the Gospel Music Workshop, which was founded by the late Reverend Cleveland. So it's a little earlier, so that those that are just getting out of college can include it on their way home or whatever, you know, stop in for a few days. And it's really a great situation. And of course, gifts and talents just have come through and just exploded the gospel scene that we're given a platform here at the work at the seminar. Mm-hmm.
To name a few.
Sean Pace, mm-hmm. John P. Key, and you know, Yolanda was already popular because she was singing with Southeast Choir in Houston, Texas, with Shirley Joyner, Carl Preacher, and Brenda Waters. And that was a gifted, talented group of young people. So Yo was already there singing, and just so many people, the late Reverend Thomas Whitfield would work with Edwin, and Donald Lawrence, of course, is here working with Edwin. Even myself, even though I was a member of the workshop and had exposure through that venue also, but working with Edwin also gave me multiple exposure. And Danny Bell Hall, the late Danny Bell Hall, was part of this in the beginning. She taught excellent class on just how to flow and move in the spirit and inspirational songwriting. I think a lot of us had like four or five different hats in those areas. Jerry Thomas was teaching the business of music. Jerry's from Cleveland, Ohio, and he was very active in music industry, the secular music industry, and he taught in the seminar in the early years. Winston Poe, who is an excellent choreographer, who was part of the Thomas Whitfield Company out of Detroit, Michigan. He was instructor in dance. And then, well, now we have Mother Shirley Berkeley. And it's a wonderful thing because she is the actual treasurer for the Gospel Music Workshop. She was appointed by Reverend Cleveland and has been the treasurer for years dealing with the finances of the workshop, but she's also an instructor in the seminar. And she's a character. She fusses the temple. I'm in that seminar because of this boy. She'd be talking about me. Because I said, you know, your expertise and the things that you know and the gifts that you can impart to a whole nother group of people who are not part of the GMWA, you could do it through this venue, you know. And she came and she loved it. And there were just a lot of great musicians, Kevin Bond, Joel Smith, you know, and just gifted, Jonathan DuBois, you know, Derek, oh Lord, I can't think of Derek's last name, Schofield, Derek Schofield, all of used to play for the family at various times, and it was just a great, great experience, you know. And we were gifted with Luana Dunlap, who sang with Bobby Jones. Jennifer Holliday came and they did a piece that Edwin had rearranged years ago. And of course, Lynette singing, you know. And then I had, of course, an opportunity, Tremaine, Bishop, Hawkins, you know. And it's just, it's really been a great experience. New gifts, new talents, new people constantly coming out. I understand during the years that I've been absent that Smokey Norfolk even came to a couple of seminars and was here, you know. So it's just been, it's a great experience. They're celebrating 23 years this year. And it's still growing, still learning process, because as time moves on and genres, the vehicle of getting the message out changes, then we shift and change too.
Mm-hmm. Ready?
First of all, I hate to talk about me, but since you asked, there are a lot of things that contributed to the ministry that the Lord has developed and has evolved from me. There, of course, the influence of my mom, who's a member of Love Center Church. She's a musician herself. She played, a lot of people don't know, and of course, they ended up finding out she could sing.
She's on one of your albums.
Yeah, she's on the Live in Oakland album, which I recorded with my former community choir, the New Generation Singers. But I began singing about age six, age seven. I'm one of the original children and founders of the Oakland Children's Chorus that was put together by the Oakland Parks and Recreation Department. And then from that came the opportunity to Casima High School graduate, and I worked with and was mentored by the late Phil Reeder, who was the director of music and arts at Casima High School, and once there realized that we had connection from earlier because he had graduated from college and been a few places and moved here from New Orleans, and he ended up being the accompanist for the Oakland Children's Chorus when I was a younger kid. So it was amazing for him to become a mentor of mine years later in the 10th grade. And then about that same time, I joined a community choir called the Voices of Christ with Helen Stevens and Francis O'Hart, who were the directors of that choir. And I wanted to sing with Edwin because 1969, they came out with Oh Happy Day and just took the nation by storm. But my mother was the one who turned me on to Ed. She heard the music and all of that.
Marion Coley.
And and there may be some of the older saints that know her as Marion Thompson. Mm-hmm. She was choir director at Ephesian Church of God in Christ. She was over the state choir for a number of years. Her and Ola Jean Andrews, great friends at the old church. And my mother actually was there when Bishop E.E. Cleveland came to the church. She was there with the late pastor Sample, when it was known as the Berkeley Church of God in Christ. So it's a long history, way back, knowing the families and musical gifts that came through that church down through the years. So as a kid, I was like two rows behind Edwin on the piano at Ephesians, but I got a chance to go, and Bishop Hawkins was on the organ. He and Tremaine were married at that time, so she was in the soprano section, you know, looking like their daughter Tristan, you know. It's funny. But I remember one time asking Ed if I could join the choir, and of course he heard me sing because I was sitting, you know, we do testimony songs and stuff, and I'd be sitting like two rows behind him just singing with the choir, you know. And because he had age limit on the choir of 15 years old, he said, the only reason I want to let you in is because you're too young. If I let you in, then I gotta make allowances for other young people. He said, but I wish I could let you in, you know. And that was in 1969. And then Helen Stevens and the Voices of Christ debuted like a year later, the second Sunday in December, in 1970, and I joined the Voices of Christ the second week of February in 1971. So, and Helen played at that time at the Progressive Baptist Church, which was directly across the street from Ephesians. So, when I needed to go rehearsals or go somewhere to sing, I would be in church and walk across the street and get in the car with Helen and go where we had to go, you know. But Helen Stevens, Francis Hart, and Shirley Hall McCoy were known as the Helen Stevens Singers. And they were part of the Gospel Music Workshop, which was just beginning at that particular time. They started in Detroit. They had an initial meeting in St. Louis, started in Detroit, I believe that's how it went, and then went back to St. Louis for the second convention. And when they went back to second convention, they came with the choir Voices of Christ. And we were support recording artists and so forth. And just moved through that time period. You know, you just did what you did. And the Lord just blessed down through those years for me to be able know of the late Reverend Isaac Douglas, the late Reverend Cleveland, late Dr. Madhouse Clark, and so many others, because at that time they were the gospel, you know, they were the ones in gospel, the movers and shakers, you know. Sarah Jordan Powell, Mom Albertina Walker, you know, and everybody was there. Late Quincy Fielding Sr., who actually was the first person who actually taught me how directing and how to really do that came about. And it's just a wealth of people who poured into me. And then having the opportunity in later years to become a member of the Love Center Church and work with Bishop Hawkins and work with Jermaine, work with Edwin. And for a short moment, Edwin had me on the road with him as keyboardist. We even do workshops. And then I became Jermaine's principal musician. She launched that on her solo career. And of course, you know, the famous Love Center Choir. And passed off with the 8901 back off the Boulevard. But I also had a community choir called the New Generation Singers that I had started in college. And we were actually college about me, the gospel choir. For 2 years we were accredited chorus and traveled around singing everywhere. And when the board of accreditation, even though we had high recommendations and things from the Lions Club and all of those type of things, civic things we had done, they decided not to give us credit anymore. So they dissolved the class, but the choir didn't want to break up, so they became the New Generation Singers. And for a number of years, I think for about 10 years, I had that choir before I moved to Southern California. So it was, you know, it was developing. And the recording career, of course, came because I had done He'll Never Let You Down with the Gospel Music Workshop, Chariots Are Coming, which was written by Stephen Roberts of the Bay Area. And picked up by Gentry McCreary, who still is a movement shaker. Gentry McCreary is the one who signed Bishop Hawkins and them to Light Records. He brought them to the world, in actuality. I think he was instrumental in bringing Andre Crouch to the public view. And then a few years after that, he started a label called Onyx, which then brought us Richard Smallwood, Vanessa Bell Armstrong, and a few other artists. And then he worked with Dr. Green with a label called Plumline. And that's the one that I came to be the first album. And the rest of it, it's a very extensive history. So, but it's a lot of stuff. You know, I've had an opportunity to perform over in Europe, over in Japan, just beautiful, beautiful times. Recording, I have a choir that calls me their director. They're in Sweden. They're called By Grace. Really can just really low down and sing, you know. And I've had an opportunity to just meet and work with some fantastic people, not just in gospel, but in secular music and different things, you know. And I still have some desires. I like to do theater, so the Lord lets me every now and then I do some theater pieces and get out. I've been on off-Broadway and been on the road with some plays, and that's another dimension because I studied drama in school, in college. So that opens up another avenue. And then in Love Center Ministries, actually I was called to preach as being a musician at Agnes Memorial Church of God in Christ with Bishop QC Simmons, Mr. Pastor. And my first sermon was preached at QC's church. And later years, I began to do some study, and I lived around the corner from Allen Temple. And Dr. J. Alfred Smith had a class that was open to anyone that was in ministry. And they were teaching a lot of the skills and so forth of being a pastor or a minister or preacher. And so I would walk around the corner and go to the classes at Allen Temple on Sunday mornings, and then catch the bus and go up to Love Center for church. And then Bishop had courses and things at the church, and Minister Edna Tatum, myself, and I'm trying to remember who else. I think it was two or three others that passed the course that Bishop had set, and he licensed and ordained me according to what God had said. And I was married in this ministry. My daughter is his goddaughter, and Tremaine's goddaughter. It's just, you know, my roots here. And I on tape, I would really like to thank the Lord, of course, but also thank the ministry of this church, because my mom was one of the daughters of the Church of God in Christ. She was a soloist, a national soloist under Mother Coffey. Those who know the history know that Mother Coffey was the second state mother in the Churches of God in Christ International. And she was the goddaughter of the late H. Barb Rogers, who was the Bishop of the Valley, the Imperial Valley in Fresno. So she, you know, had privy to a lot of places and things and discussions that others, you know, were not privy to. And a lot of things happened. And she, for a little while in my life, she walked away from church, not necessarily from God, but just walked away from church, you know, and things. But I'm so grateful for the ministry of Love Center, the ministry of Bishop Hawkins, and just the people of God there, because when I came, she came to visit, because I encouraged her to just come and see, you know, the church, and she came to visit, and never left until the time of departure to go home with the Lord, you know, and it was just great. It was just a great thing. So I'm eternally grateful to this ministry and, of course, to God for the reassociation with the body of Christ in mass and large, and just seeing my mother really enjoy herself in the Lord with the people of God that she had come to love here at the Love Center Church. So, you know, and things keep happening. I've had a chance to perform with the Boston Pops and have that on CD, but we didn't put it out, you know. I'm working on a few things right now that God has blessed. But a lot of my music training and my ear training, from Phil Reader to Helen Stevens to Edwin Hawkins to Walter Hawkins, you know, and to others that have just poured into my life. And so when you hear me and hear my albums, you hear all of those genres of jazz and blues and gospel that are what my heritage, my makeup are. I'm still developing. I've got a few projects in my spirit. When am I going to record? I don't know. But I am in the process of helping some other artists right at this point, trying to build something that will have integrity and will bless them because of the gifting that God has given to them, but will bless people that hear them also. That's what I'm doing.